पैनकेराटाइटिस।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर नम्रता. At the outset, I would like to thank All India Ophthalmology Society for giving me this opportunity to present my views on the topic. So I'm going to present a very brief of how to approach a case of keratitis. So what happens in the clinic when the patient walks in? So let's take an example of this patient, which is a 17-year-old male who presented with pain, watering, redness, and decreased vision since 7 days. You see, it's a very typical keratitis which enters into your clinic. So what do you do? Either you start directly the antimicrobials or you go in for a systematic workup. So let's concentrate to approach two. Let's plan a systematic workup and how to do. The first and the foremost thing is take a good history, which includes what is the duration of the lesion, the trauma, was there any associated, any sac infection, conjunctivitis, any ocular disorder, or contact lens use or recurrence of such lesion in before. We also have to take systemic factors into account when we're dealing with keratitis. The first being, is the patient a diabetic, an immunocompromised state, having any nutritional deficiency, was in coma, is an alcoholic, or having any associated collagen vascular disease like rheumatoid arthritis. The patient usually presents with decreased visual acuity, photophobia, pain, redness, swelling, and discharge. May have some varied presentation, but these are the most common. Normally, the eye has defense mechanism in the form of blinking, and tears have IgA, lysozyme, and cool surface. These prevent the eye from getting infection or the cornea from getting infection. The most important being the intact corneal epithelium. But there are risk factors which penetrate through this intact epithelium, be it the lid problems like entropion ectropion or a palsy of the seventh nerve, or a dry eye, decrocystitis, contact lens wear, or any other corneal lesion which is already present before, which would have been a non-infective state but become infective later on. So keratitis can be suppurative or non-suppurative. In this presentation, we're going to concentrate more on the suppurative type. The patient may present at any of the four stages, be it progressive infiltration, active ulceration, regression, or cicatrization. So here is the progressive infiltration stage where there's adherence and entry of the organism and resultant destruction with necrosis. Active ulceration, necrosis increases and margins and flow usually show grayish infiltration. Regression, the patient has started to improve and the natural host immunity and treatment has started to work. Finally, a cicatrization. This is what we all want from keratitis. And the vessels start to regress completely and residual ghost vessels may be there. So if we just look at this case from each stage, the first is the progressive infiltration stage of the ulcer, the same ulcer going into active ulceration, regression, and finally cicatrization. We can grade the ulcers in three form, in three parameters, be it mild, moderate, and severe. To evaluate a patient, we need to know the following parameters, be it the visual acuity, dimensions, the height of hypopyon, the reaction, whether it is there, and obviously do a B scan to rule out any endophthalmitis which might be present along with keratitis. So documentation of ulcer becomes very, very important. There is a planned sort of color coding which is there for all the ulcers to be documented in the file or wherever you are noting, even in the EMR now. So I come back to the same patient. This patient, when they presented to us with a systematic approach, and when he presented, he was on all sort of medications like an antibiotic, antifungal, and an antiviral. And then what we started doing, we went in for a proper approach wherein this. Why it's just not moving forward. Yeah. So microbiological evaluation was done for this patient and it came out to be a gram-negative bacilli. So we thought what to do next and we knew that we might be dealing with a Pseudomonas in this case. And with the proper therapy, the patient started to respond. This is the report which came out to be with the growth in both the agars and we did a sensitivity pattern wherein it was sensitive to most of the medications. Medication started as per the sensitivity report. And the patient did respond within 2 weeks. So this is what we want for all the cases of keratitis in our practice. So the magic potion here was that we knew our enemy and it was a systematic approach. corneal scraping becomes the most important here. So how do we do this? A KOAT mount is a very simple test, and it has 92% sensitivity and 96% specificity for fungus. You see, a spectrum of organisms can be viewed just with the KOAT mount staining, and this is how the fungus may look like. You may even be able to differentiate. You can also see acanthamoeba and nocardia just with a KOAT mount, just on a KOAT mount. So this is one of the most important tests. And this was one of the studies which was carried out at LVPI, wherein the KOH mount was definitely highlighted as one of the most cost-effective and the direct rapid test wherein fungal keratitis could be diagnosed and others could be ruled out. So this is how you can do a treatment of these patients. Staining techniques wherein Gram staining becomes important, wherein you can see different organisms in different colors. You just have to get used to it. And in most of our practice, it is very easy to do it right in the OPD. Just you need a good wash basin and just two stains and a KOH mount there. So you can diagnose which type of bacteria is there broadly. May not be able to come to the exact form for which you will need medias, which may be in the form of blood agar, chocolate agar, Saburo's agar, or non-nutrient agar, depending if you want to be going for acanthamoeba. The other media may be needed for many special atypical organisms. So if we are dealing with the bacterial keratitis, I'll just take you to snippets of cases wherein a specific organism presents in a specific way. So before that, we did a study of 625 patients with infective keratitis in our hospital, wherein we found trauma was the most commonly associated for predisposing factor, and the culture sensitivity in these cases was also identified, with Staphylococcus species and Fusarium becoming the most common bacteria and fungus which are isolated, and Amikacin and Vancomycin remained the most sensitive antibiotic against these against bacterial organisms. And we found that even now the fluoroquinolones do have significant sensitivity and can be used as a first line empirical treatment for bacterial ulcers. And this is the study which we've just completed, and it has been accepted in one of the international journals. So if you just come to snippets, this is a patient with a pneumococcus keratitis, wherein the common presentation is because of post-trauma, sac infection, and suture abscess. This is important specifically in pneumococcus, that most of us are seeing suture infiltrates, and most of it comes out to be pneumococcus. Anybody with a sac infection is also associated with pneumococcus. This is one of the serial pictures of a suture infiltrate, wherein just to have knowing the organism and treating properly led to a good outcome. In compromised patients, we should also always suspect a Staphylococcus keratitis, especially in dry eye and bullous keratopathy, and with herpes on steroids for a long time. It is localized with fairly distinct borders, and surrounding stroma in these cases is usually healthy. This is one of the cases wherein, again, it responded to the treatment. We are all scared of Pseudomonas keratitis because it has a very virulent course, and it usually presents with a grayish ground glass appearance of the stroma, thick mucopurulent discharge, and melting of the cornea. And we feel that right in front of the eyes, of our eyes, the cornea started to melt. So this was a case of post-keratoconus, CXL done for keratoconus, and this is the second day, and the patient was on BCL, and the patient did present with an infiltrate. We did a scraping and actually found Pseudomonas. Treated it with properly, admitted the patient, treated as per the reports, and it did heal. And finally, the RGP trial was done and the patient improved. And one good point, I wouldn't want it, was that the cornea flattened and the trial was much better than it was before. But obviously, we do not want this as an outcome. A fungal keratitis clinically does present with as a dry-looking, grayish white and elevated rolled-out margins with satellite lesions which may be there, infiltrates, and endothelial plaques and immune rings. This is how clinically we can differentiate a fungal with a bacteria. But definitely, you do need to do scraping to rule out the fungus in most cases. So this was one of the cases which presented an infiltrate which did have feathery margins, and on KOH, it did show fungal hyphae with the growth, and on treatment did respond well. This is another patient which presented with the epithelial defect, feathery extensions, and when we did a KOH mount, did show hyphae, and with just on medical treatment, did respond beautifully and led to final scarring. Because of the depth, we did start the patient even on the oral antifungals here. So fungal ulcer, we all say that candida is another part of the fungal ulcer, wherein this is one of the cases where there is a chorobutton sort of a lesion, and it did respond well to the medical therapy. So debridement becomes important in these cases, and it will be discussed more in detail in the presentations coming along. This is a post LASIK patient having an infiltrate. Obviously, flap was lifted, scraping done, and started on the topical medications, did respond well. So when we are assessing the case of keratitis, we need to know whether it is responding to the treatment or not, for which blunting of perimeters of the infiltrate is important, reduction in the inflammation, and progressive epithelialization. If it's progressing, we have to admit the patient, and we need to review the microbiology results. We need to do corneal biopsy and suspect other possible causes. If there's thinning or perforation, then you need to do a glue or a tectonic PK at that point. This was a KOH positive patient. Again, did perforate 2 weeks later. Started to respond, but did perforate. Did a glue, did well after that. So this is another patient of fungal keratitis, and did show a lot of thinning, more or less a medicamentosa sort of a picture. Did a tarsorrhaphy, continued on treatment, did respond well. We may need to go in for a therapeutic keratoplasty for progressive non-responsive ulcers. So when you have to assess when you want to do it, this was one of the cases with the centralized deep ulcer, not responding much to the medications. You've got to do an ultrasound to see if it's an endophthalmitis associated. If it's a fungal, preferably an LFT beforehand only, because you may be starting the oral antifungals, and then go ahead and do the therapeutic keratoplasty. And they do well if it is done on time. Post the keratoplasty, you can review your results with your button analysis and your the biopsy report of the cell. So I would conclude by saying that it's important to make the clinical diagnosis of any case presenting with infective keratitis or any case of corneal ulcer. A proper documentation is the key to success, because you will be knowing how the patient is progressing. This indispensable role of microbiology in treating the corneal ulcers or infective keratitis. And we need to be specific in treatment. We don't need to start all sort of medications thinking that it may respond to any of them. So we have to know what we are attacking and just attack with one weapon, which is going to be the most effective. So thank you so much. And I would like to acknowledge our Department of Cornea and the lab services at our hospital. Thank you. Back to you, Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha. I think you set the ball rolling now, and now we'll come to the specifics after this general discussion on workup of a case of microbial keratitis. And I have none other than Dr. Prashant Garg, who's going to be talking about different aspects of bacterial keratitis. Thank you for joining us, Prashant, today, and we look forward to your talk.
Thank you, Namrata, and good afternoon, everybody who is participating in this very exciting workshop. We are going to be learning quite a lot through this workshop. The title of my talk will be to discuss with you some of the aspects that we confront whenever we are treating cases of microbial keratitis in general and bacterial keratitis in particular. The objectives of my talk will be to give an answer to the question, what is the role of microbiology in the management of corneal ulcer? This has been touched by a previous speaker, but I'll be putting a scenario to it so that you can use this tool judiciously. We will also discuss what is the role of fluoroquinolone versus fortified drops. Is there a role of corticosteroid in the management of corneal infections, especially bacterial keratitis? Let us look at this patient who presented to us with the history of pain, redness, watering, and diminution of vision of 2 days duration. She was a soft contact lens wearer and used to sleep with the lenses on occasionally. I am sure with the clinical picture and the history, it should not be very difficult to answer the question of what is she suffering from and what is the etiology of this case. However, the question that haunts most of the clinicians who deal with this case is, even when I understand what is the most likely etiology, should I be doing corneal scraping for this patient or not? And I think if you pull out literature, both in peer-reviewed publications as well as a standard textbook, you will find that the classical recommendation for any case of microbial keratitis is that in all these cases, a detailed microbiology must be performed, and the treatment is to be based on both microscopic examination as well as the growth on culture media. However, the real life situation is that close to 90% plus ophthalmologists treat these cases empirically without paying attention to the nature of organism causing these infections. And that was very clear in a large series that we analyzed, that many of these patients are indiscriminately treated with a combination of antibiotics, antifungal, antivirals, and some of these patients are treated even with corticosteroid before starting definitive treatment. Now, why this kind of a behavior is there? On one hand, a classical textbook and peer-reviewed publication highlights that all these patients must undergo microbiology, whereas we see that clinicians are not buying that recommendation and are treating cases empirically. And it is all because a classical microbiology workup comprises of microscopic examination of smear using Gram stain and KOH calcofluor white, and inoculation of multiple culture media, which promote growth of bacteria, fungi, and parasite. And some of the authors even recommend use of polymerase chain reaction. If you have to know the antimicrobial susceptibility, then your lab must also be equipped to do antibiotic susceptibility, either using Kirby bar disc diffusion method or E-strip. Now, all of this test, if you have to do, will require a very well equipped laboratory, staff that is trained to handle these ocular samples, and there is cost and logistics involved. And it is because of this reason that most ophthalmologists are reluctant to either avail these facilities, even if they are available in their towns, or do not have access to the labs that are equipped so well. And that is basically the reason that these patients are treated empirically. So we are again at the crossroad of, should we be doing microbiology in every case, or are there some kind of a compromise that can be made realizing the ground reality where most ophthalmologists do not have access to microbiology laboratory? And I think to answer this question, there was a workshop held in 2005 by World Health Organization South Asia region, where that group was tasked to develop guidelines for the management of corneal ulcer in countries where the microbiology facilities may not be available. The group considered following facts. Most of the corneal ulcers are caused by bacteria. If you for a time ignore the data that is coming from tertiary eye care center, in majority of the community centers, probably the bacteria are the most common causes of corneal ulceration. To add to this fact is another fact that most of the antibacterial agents are bactericidal, and if instituted on time, they are likely to result in resolution of infection. And there are demonstrable clinical responses seen within days of administering appropriate antibacterial therapy. Other facts that were considered were related to if we are going to miss on fungal and acanth amoeba as etiological agent. And the group thought that we have to remember that most of the antifungal agents are fungistatic. They demonstrate clinical response in weeks, not in days. And if you combine antibacterial with antifungal, then the cocktail is likely to be toxic and make the management more complicated. Further, it was also identified that if you use 10% KOH, the presence of fungal filament will guide you to initiate treatment with antifungal drug. And therefore, the microbiology workup that was recommended by the group was that a simple light microscopic examination of 10% potassium hydroxide smear can be a good tool combined with clinical assessment in starting treatment in a rational manner. What was their recommendation? The recommendation was that if you are dealing with a patient who is suffering from an ulcer which is around 2 millimeter in size and has no features of fungal or parasitic infection, then these patients can be treated even without microbiology workup. These patients can be started empirical treatment with a broad spectrum antibiotic. On the other hand, if you are having a patient who is having a large and serious ulcer, then there is no point in wasting time by empirical therapy. It is better to know your enemy and start a specific therapy as early as possible. The committee also made a recommendation that since in a country we need to know the epidemiology of corneal ulcers, they said that a teaching institution must ideally treat every patient of corneal ulcer based on the microbiology. And they must also invest into doing antimicrobial susceptibility so that they can develop guidelines that can be followed by the community ophthalmologists. The next important dilemma that we face whenever we treat corneal ulcer cases is what kind of antibiotic we should initiate. And there is always a dilemma, should I use fluoroquinolone, which are commercially available, versus should these patients be started treatment with fortified cefazolin or vancomycin or other fortified antibiotics? This dilemma is primarily because the cefazolin or vancomycin drugs are not commercially available as ophthalmic preparation. If you prepare them from injections or intravenous preparations, they have limited shelf life. There are issues with their pH and tonicity. And since they are dispensed in higher concentration, they may be toxic. On the other hand, fluoroquinolones are commercially available. Their shelf life is not an issue. They have been shown in clinical trials to be safe and non-toxic. Further, the bacterial keratitis study very clearly documented that monotherapy with fluoroquinolone was as effective as combination therapy with cefazolin and tobramycin. And there was a time, in particularly after 1990, when ciprofloxacin and ofloxacin were made available in the market, that many of the patients of corneal ulcer were treated with the monotherapy with fluoroquinolones. But unfortunately, these first generation of fluoroquinolones started developing resistance, both against keratitis isolates, but also conjunctivitis and endophthalmitis isolates. Soon, the 8-methoxyfluoroquinolones were brought in the market, and people thought that because of the dual mechanism of action, this group of antibiotics are unlikely to develop resistance, and they still maintain a broad spectrum of activity both against gram-positive and gram-negative organisms. Further, they were also effective against cipro-resistant organisms. So there was a recommendation that we should start replacing first-generation fluoroquinolones with the fourth-generation fluoroquinolones in the treatment of corneal ulcer. However, the resistance monitoring of organisms against these antibiotics very clearly revealed that over a period of time, even these group of antibiotics have started showing reduced sensitivity, particularly against gram-positive organisms, and they have lost their capability of being effective against cipro-resistant gram-negative organisms. So we are back to the square one, where we are now debating whether is it appropriate to treat patients of corneal ulcer with fluoroquinolone monotherapy. The recommendation that is currently made is that if you are treating a less severe corneal ulcer, an ulcer which is less than or equal to 2 millimeter in size, then fluoroquinolone monotherapy with a broad spectrum fluoroquinolone, that is 8-methoxyfluoroquinolone, will be a rationale treatment to start with. However, if you are treating a severe corneal ulcer, then probably it will be appropriate to start treatment with fortified antibiotics, which covers both gram-positive and gram-negative, and therefore recommendation was combine fortified cefazolin with fortified aminoglycosides, or you can choose first generation fluoroquinolone because they still preserve good activity against gram-negative organisms. The next question or the next issue that will come is, should we only treat these patients with antibiotics, or can we give a combination of antibiotics and corticosteroid, or should the approach be starting treatment with antibiotic and when you have a response, add corticosteroid? If you are discussing the third issue, then it will be important that for how long should you give antibiotic before you can safely start corticosteroid. But the more important issue whenever we talk about corticosteroid is there a real benefit? And I think this question is an age-old question. There are groups which debate that in favor of corticosteroid, whereas there is another group or a school of thought which is against use of corticosteroids in the management of corneal ulcer. And this debate is as old as 1952, when the first paper was published onto the use of corticosteroid in the treatment of corneal ulcer. So almost over 70 years, we have not been able to resolve this question of what is the value of corticosteroid in the management of corneal ulcer. The believers of school in favor of corticosteroid are saying that because corneal ulcer comprises of infiltration by leukocytes, and the cytokines that are released from these leukocytes are promoter of tissue destruction, therefore, arresting the leukocyte infiltration is going to be beneficial. So the expectation from the use of corticosteroid is, are they reducing corneal scar? Do they use, or is the use of corticosteroid results in improved visual acuity? And does it really shorten the duration of disease? And I think all of these are of questionable value, but the most important question that always haunts a clinician in using corticosteroid is, are they safe? Are they not going to be worsening the clinical situation? Kirk Wilhelmus published this beautiful article in 2002, where he tried to do the meta-analysis of all the literature that was published until that point of time and talked about indecision about the use of corticosteroids for bacterial keratitis. He found that most of the literature very clearly documents that prior corticosteroid therapy can lead to worse outcome in patients of bacterial keratitis. And similar were the results when corticosteroid is administered simultaneously with antibiotic at the start of treatment. What he found is that nobody has really looked until 2002 on the issue of antibiotics followed by corticosteroids. And this was the rationale for the SCOT trial that was done to ascertain what is the true value of corticosteroids. However, the study, which was a very high class study, did not find any difference in the group that was treated with corticosteroid versus those which were treated with placebo, as far as best spectacle corrected visual acuity is concerned. The group also did not find any major difference in the side effects or the complications. They performed subgroup analysis and then thought that probably the only value corticosteroid may have is in the management of severe corneal ulcer. They concluded that there is no major safety concern, but there are no major overall value that corticosteroid therapy has. Subsequent to this, there was a Cochrane review that was published that again looked into various evidences that have been in the literature so far and they also did not find any beneficial effect of use of corticosteroid. So what is the sense that we can make from these studies? And I think it is very clear that at this point of time, we do not have very conclusive effect, a benefit in the use of corticosteroid for corneal ulcer. Let me now end by showing you a case which highlights another dilemma that we face, that when many times you start an appropriate therapy and still the patients are not benefited. This 25-year male who presented with a six-week history of following a corneal foreign body removal, we did corneal scraping, the smears were negative, and culture showed a growth of Corynebacterium on one medium. We started patient on ciprofloxacin. This is a case we saw in 98, and atropine eye drop. Patient showed initial response, but then there was a worsening at almost at 4 weeks. We changed drugs to cefazolin, again showed some response, and then came with the increase in symptoms. At that point of time, we thought, what is happening? We are treating based on microbiology, we are using antibiotics, and still this patient is not showing response. We paid attention to the history and the clinical course, and it was very obvious to us that there are certain features that we should pay attention to rather than empirically switching to another antibiotic or add corticosteroid. And these features were that this patient was having a very long history of 6 weeks before it presented to us and 8 weeks while he was with us. He had a history of corneal foreign body that was removed by local ophthalmologist, and then this patient was showing waxing and waning course. All of these typical history and a review of the clinical data clearly suggested that we should do acid fast staining, which revealed Mycobacterium chelonii. It is important that we should take into account these cases where there is a typical history and suspect non-tubercular mycobacteria. Now, why is it important? Because these patients do not have a very characteristic clinical picture. It all depends upon what kind of predisposing factor they are in. Trauma is one of them, and the other predisposing factor is prior surgery. Number two, the clinical picture, although is described as a cracked windshield appearance, but is not often seen in an analysis that we did at our center. Thirdly, that many of these cases do not stain well with the Gram stain, which is a usual stain that we use. And therefore, most of these organisms remain undetected on microscopy. And unless the culture is carefully viewed, you are likely to miss. And the only source that we have is that a diagnosis purely depends upon the clinical vigilance of physicians. Once you make the diagnosis, the treatment is relatively easier. Amikacin is the drug of choice. If administered in 2.5% concentration, most of these patients respond. So to conclude, microbiology is important, particularly in severe corneal ulcer. Fluoroquinolone monotherapy is best reserved for small ulcers, and corticosteroids have no proven value and therefore should be used very judiciously. In chronic cases, cases where you have started appropriate treatment and they are still not showing response, consider atypical mycobacteria. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank Professor Namrata Sharma and AIOS for giving me this opportunity to share my views on bacterial corneal ulcer with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prashant. I think that was a very lucid and a comprehensive talk on, and it cleared so many doubts actually, which people would have about bacterial keratitis, and especially about atypical mycobacterial keratitis, which Professor Tityal would remember. We had a case which was so difficult to manage after LASIK, and you know, the thing was the same. You start steroids, they become worse. You stop steroids, you know, it kind of rebounds. So next I would, Rajesh, can you invite me to give the talk?
Apne aapko bulane mein harz kya hai yaar.
So next we have Dr. Namrata Sharma, who will be talking about fungal keratitis.
Is the screen there or it's not there?
It's there.
It's there. You just have to make it full screen.
Slideshow.
So I was teaching everybody and now everybody is teaching me how to do it. Okay. So I would be talking to you about practical tips in the management of fungal keratitis. And we have talked about it at various platforms and at various fora. But we would be talking mainly about the practical way in which it can be managed. There are no financial or proprietary interests in any of the products mentioned in this presentation. And it does become important for us because almost half our cases are fungal in etiology. It is important again where you are sitting. So if you are in the Northwest India, Aspergillus is most common. And if you are in the Southeast India, then it is Fusarium which is most common. And of course, we are all aware of the clinical features, which are redness, pain, diminution of vision, but it tends to be a little more indolent, as Manisha also pointed out in her presentation. And then you have classical picture of dry, thick, raised texture with feathery margins, satellite lesions, endothelial plaques, and fixed hypopyon and abscess. And of course, if you have pigmentation such as this, that means it is most likely because of dermatitis fungi. And Fusarium tends to have a more severe course. And if it does get treated, then you see that the pigment is disappearing. For dermatitis fungi, in the morning, I had a question. The drug of choice is, again, natamycin. Then 10% KOH was shown long back that it has sensitivity of 91 to 99%. And you do send cultures on Sebrot's dextrose agar. In all those cases, which in fact are culture negative, and you still think that they are fungal keratitis, these can be sent for PCR or for confocal microscopy. And if you pick up hyphae in that, antifungal agents could be started. Now, this was a thesis which was done at our center, spectral domain anterior segment OCT in fungal keratitis, where we looked at the activity of fungal keratitis. Actually, you can, on the anterior segment OCT itself, you can pick up the features, and we classified as to what the active features or anterior segment OCT are, and clinically correlated with the clinical picture. So 5% natamycin is the drug of choice hourly during the daytime, 2 hourly at bedtime, and round the clock for the initial 3 to 4 days, and you have to taper only, in fact, you have to decrease the dose after 4 to 7 days if it is responding. If it is not, then you have to add 1% voriconazole, and the therapy classically lasts for 3 to 4 weeks. And these are some of the cases of Fusarium keratitis on topical natamycin. And there is a limitation for the commercially available preparations: poor ocular penetration, poor bioavailability, and toxicity of the currently available drugs. So the MUT1 trial did tell us that voriconazole should not be used as a monotherapy in cases of filamentous keratitis. It did not look at the role of combination therapy in cases of fungal keratitis. And although systemic antifungals were advocated for large ulcers, deep ulcers, scleritis, post-PK keratitis, and ophthalmitis, and voriconazole as well as ketoconazole could be given in 200 milligrams BD, but MUT2 did tell us that systemic has limited role to play. So this is just to show a case. Sometimes when topical natamycin 5% doesn't work, what do you do? So you add either systemic ketoconazole if the patient is not able to afford systemic voriconazole, or you can add voriconazole if the patient is able to afford it. And this is just to show how a case of fungal tunnel keratitis responded to topical and systemic antifungal therapy. Now, MUT2 also did also point out the finding that Fusarium keratitis may benefit from the additional role of oral voriconazole to topical natamycin. And so we did do a randomized control study where we looked at oral voriconazole versus oral ketoconazole. And in terms of duration of resolution of the infiltrates, we found that there was no difference, which is good because you can give ketoconazole or voriconazole depending upon the affordability of the patient. But in terms of the tear film and the serum concentrations, at all points in time, the voriconazole was found to be higher as compared to ketoconazole. So this was possibly a theoretical advantage of voriconazole because it did not clinically translate into to the results, and you never know if your numbers were more probably it would. So this is the paper that we published. Then we came to targeted drug delivery because there were cases where topical doesn't work, systemic doesn't work. You add to topical and systemic, it doesn't work. Then what do you do? So initially, amphotericin B, targeted drug therapy was started, came into vogue, 5 to 7.5 microgram per 0.1 ml. And later on, voriconazole became the fashion of the day with 5,200 microgram per 0.1 ml. And this is just to show how intracameral amphotericin B did help in a case. And of course, there can be problems in the form of anterior chamber inflammation, cataract, pain, and theoretically, there could be secondary infection, although there are no studies to say so. Then we could give intrastomal injections in deep mycotic keratitis, non-perforated corneal ulcers, not responding to conventional topical and systemic antifungal therapy for 4 weeks. And these are some of the anecdotal reports. And why did we start it in our center? The reason was this case. This was the very first case which came to us. And this was in fact referred from outside, was on all medications and did not respond. And we were about to take this case for a therapeutic graft. And we said, why not try intrastomal injections? And we tried intrastomal injections and the response was so dramatic that we were encouraged to use this this mode of therapy in our armamentarium of the care that we do for microbial keratitis and especially fungal keratitis. So this is what we published, the first three case reports. And then subsequently, if you see the anecdotal case reports, they are there, you know, where intrastomal injections do help. I think it is a matter of timing and it is also a matter of case selection. And this was a randomized controlled trial, which helped us to understand that to topical natamycin, if you add topical voriconazole, then the results are better than if only topical natamycin is there. And so combination therapy probably has a greater role to play than a single drug therapy for fungal keratitis. And intrastomal voriconazole in this cohort did not show a significant difference when it was added to the topical natamycin therapy. And this is just to show how it is done. There is no big deal about it. You just wash the anterior segment, the anterior chamber with the antifungal drug and then give intrastomal injections, which are given with a 30 gauge needle in an area which is relatively clear, where it is not so thinned out, and the reflex is very much like the reflex of a phaco wound hydration. And this is just to show the cases from that study: topical natamycin and topical voriconazole, topical natamycin and intrastomal voriconazole. And vascularization, when both the groups were compared, was found to be comparable. So this is what we proposed. And I must give credit to Professor Tityal for this, because when I was doing this presentation about a few years ago, he said, you should come out with the algorithm because people don't know what to start when. So this was, in fact, conceived at that time. So if you have a case of fungal keratitis and the involvement is less than 5 millimeters in size, with less than 2/3 stroma, topical natamycin can be started. If there is no response, you add topical voriconazole to it. Again, if it is more than 2/3 stroma, more than 5 millimeters in size, systemic can be started. If there is no, and topical both can be started. And if there is no response to it, then targeted therapy can be given in the form of intracamerals or intrastromals or both, depending upon where the lesion is. And of course, if it doesn't respond here, that is when the ulcer size is less, then we can always shift to this column on the right side. And this is the paper we published based on a prospective cohort of 223 patients. And then subsequently published this with the help of all our departments, the ocular microbiology, the ocular pharmacology, and the various people who worked on this. So when we gave medical therapy alone, the success rate was 74%. When we added intrastromal, then the success rate, it became higher. And that is why we called it the TST protocol, or the topical systemic and the targeted protocol for fungal keratitis. Now, sometimes you may have to resort to more than one, you have to do a multi-prong attack. This was a case of therapeutic keratoplasty where again, reinfection occurred. And then again, intrastromal injection was given. So sometimes one weapon doesn't work. It has to be more than one. And this I've talked about. And we are now doing a clinical study with Netasol, where we've combined it with the polymer to make it soluble. And if you look at the pharmacokinetics, they are better than suspension of natamycin, which is currently available commercially. And this is just to show a case again, post-LASIK fusarium keratitis with intrastromal letazole that we did, and it responded to therapy completely. This is how the healing of a corneal ulcer should be. With every passage of time, the epithelialization occurs and a faint corneal scar forms. And therapeutic keratoplasty would be dealt by Professor Tityal. He would be talking to you about details. So to conclude, geographical variation does occur in cases of fungal keratitis. Natamycin is the first drug of choice. You may add voriconazole if there's no response. Systemic voriconazole, I believe, does have a role to play, although many would feel otherwise. Targeted therapy is useful in recalcitrant cases, and surgical management has to be resorted to for cases which are not amenable to medical therapy and injections. And I would like to thank everybody who's worked on the several studies that we have published, you know, while embarking on our journey on fungal keratitis. And thank you for your kind attention. So can we now ask our next speaker to speak, Dr. Ritu Arora, on viral keratitis? Meanwhile, we can take one question which comes every time. Is there any role of betadine drops in fungal keratitis? To my mind, there is none. The other panelists can react on it.
We also did a study of povidone iodine in the management of bacterial and fungal keratitis, and there was no proven benefit in a randomized control trial. So I feel that betadine for proven microbial keratitis have no role except probably in the most superficial cases.
May I add that betadine is a contact sterilizer. Basically, it treats where it touches. So, like Professor Prashant said, only if contact is there, effect will also be there. And penetrative treatment is not to be expected with betadine treatment for microbial keratitis.
So, ma'am, can we have your talk now?
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Nam. You're getting my slides? Are you getting my slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So thanks for inviting me to be a part of this symposium. And I'll be speaking on viral keratitis and attaining the right balance as to we see number of cases where when antiviral needs to be given, the steroid is being given, or when a proper systemic antiviral is to be given, something else is given, or maybe a viral is mistaken as bacterial. So I really title the talk as attaining the right balance. You know, viral keratitis is very, very specific as it differs from my earlier speaker. They talked about bacterial and fungal keratitis, and it is chronic and it is recurrent. The important thing is it is recurrent with frequent relapses. And earlier it was thought that it is like in developing country, we don't see it, but it's not so uncommon. It leads to painful and sight-threatening infection. The recurring part occurs in the stroma and the endothelial component of the cornea. And morbidity of the viral keratitis is through the corneal scarring and neovascularization. Affects the quality of life when patient is not experiencing active infection. And the important part of virus is that it just goes and is latent in the trigeminal ganglion. And with the proper trigger, when it happens, it comes back. So these are the different typical presentations of viral keratitis, which we see. That this is a typical presentation, which we get a dendrite, which is like very, I mean, in a tertiary care center, you see less of such cases. You see more of complicated cases. It's only the first contact patients presents things like that. And these cases, you may miss them if you don't see them properly, especially on an oblique light. And only when we strain them, that this is when this typical dendrite comes out. And when you give them topical antiviral in the form of topical acyclovir, it heals beautifully in this form. The clinical presentations of viral keratitis we really have to see whether the virus is involving the epithelium of the cornea or the stroma of the cornea or both, or it is involving the endothelium or deep stroma or the uvea. So accordingly, the treatment differs. And once it is involving the epithelium of the cornea, it is usually infectious, and therefore we name it as an infectious epithelial keratitis. The presentations may be in the typical dendrite, or it may be a geographical or an amoeboid colon ulcer. If it involves the stroma, which is actually usually an immune response to the virus in the epithelium, the presentation may be just in the form of distiform keratitis, or a necrotizing stromal keratitis, or an interstitial keratitis. Another way virus involves, it may be just simple endothelitis, and it may present with deep stromal edema. Herpetic uveitis is not uncommon, or at times you may have a keratouveitis. The typical thing about uveitis in herpes is that they have a very high intraocular pressure, and not uncommonly I've seen these patients are mistaken as cases of acute angle closure glaucoma. We have to be very, very careful when you're managing these cases. And of course, a neurotrophic keratitis. So this is how a typical geographical ulcer comes out, and patients normally present to us in this kind of a manner when there is present a defect, when there is present a defect. And so you really have to see that where there's a defect, stain it, outline the margins, and see underlying stroma, because there might be a melting happening in that kind of a case. And these kind of cases, till the patient is not stain negative, you need to give them topical antivirals only. Or you may give them systemic antiviral, which we'll be discussing later, as the first course. There is no role of steroids at this stage. It's only when the ulcer starts responding, it becomes stain negative. That's the time when you add topical steroids, diluted steroids to begin with in QID form. An ulcer starting from here, you can give them this kind of a picture later. But our problem is that patient may not come to us directly in this form. They come in a different mix and match kind of a form. And then you have to realize that what form of viral keratitis we are dealing with. So herpetic stromal keratitis is usually, as I told you, an immune response to epithelial disease. It's an immune response to herpes simplex virus, which is invading the anterior stroma. And there occurs or through the viral reactivation of the latent herpes virus in the sensory nerves. It may be non-necrotizing or a necrotizing inflammation. Not uncommonly, a necrotizing inflammation is mistaken as a fungal keratitis. I've seen that kind of thing also happening. And a non-necrotizing, when it presents to you typically in the form of a disciform keratitis, may be just missed as a simple corneal scar if somebody doesn't see it very clearly. Typical disciform keratitis has an intact epithelium, and it's maybe focal or diffuse, or it may be multifocal associated with uveitis. While a necrotizing stromal keratitis has actually real necrosis in the stroma, and it you feel as if it's an abscess in the stromal part which is happening. There occurs ulceration, and there is dense necrosis in the stroma. It may or may not be with epithelial defect. In necrotizing keratitis, HSV DNA has been isolated, and there may be cases when we get severe inflammatory response in herpetic stromal keratitis, and there may be a melt, which I've seen happening in front of me, and I really couldn't figure out what was happening, and with thinning and perforation. So this is the different pictures of stromal keratitis, which we'll go over. So you may get a stromal keratitis with this kind of a diffuse corneal edema. And in case it happens after a patient has undergone cataract surgery, sometimes it happens, patient is put on steroids, might have a mild nebulomacular opacity here, put on steroid, and then there occurs a reactivation, patient presents to you like this, maybe third or the fourth week post-cataract surgery, and it may be mistaken as a pseudophakic bullus or maybe a localized desmoid detachment. But you have to be very careful in these cases. So this I'm trying to show as one eye was like this, and this was the fellow eye of this patient. So the fellow eye patient had already had a graft. This was the second graft for this patient. And it's in the right eye patient presented to us like this. Hello. So for me, the diagnosis was very simple, that we are dealing with a case of a stromal keratitis. And if you really look at it, you will see fine KPs on the endothelium. So these kind of cases, my line of treatment is to put them oral antivirals and give them topical steroids. And this is what when you ultimately lead to a scar formation in these cases. This is what I'm trying to show you is a necrotizing keratitis when the lesion may involve 6 to 7 millimeter. And you can see this dense yellowish kind of a look over here, and you may think that there is pus, but it's actually not pus.
Could I write a mail? Write a mail to me. Just write a mail to me so that it comes into the system.
And then once you have this kind of a localized area, and there might be irregularity, there's a lot of vascularization, they're chronic cases. And these cases respond very nicely to give them oral acyclovir, 400 mg, 5 times a day. In the acute phase, I like to give them. And this is what I've tried to show, that in acute phase, when put on oral acyclovir, how this central yellowish or the necrotic part starts diminishing and ultimately it disappears. So this is actually a direct infection of the corneal stroma with severe host inflammatory reaction, where oral acyclovir is a boon. You may give a valacyclovir also, which we'll discuss later. There may be other presentation of viral keratitis. It is a diffuse kind of a stromal keratitis. There's a deeper layer of the corneal stroma, which are diffusely affected, and there is no associated epithelial lesion. It's like deep keratitis, and they respond beautifully to steroids. Topical steroids. This is what I'm trying to show you. The bugbear of viral keratitis is that it's the recurrence. So I have now patients who are following me for close to 15 to 20 years, and they know it because then once they get the symptom, they come back. And this is one patient who has this kind of a lesion. He has this kind of a lesion over here. And other eye, of course, he's not seeing. And he keeps getting recurrences. Once he gets a recurrence, there are the local edema. He's used to have some kind of vision, maybe 636. And once this edema comes up, the vision goes down. And so that's the time for me to know that he has to be put back onto oral acyclovir. Because oral acyclovir, we normally put them up for good 6 to 8 months, 10 months. And patients sometimes ask you, when are they going to be off oral acyclovir? So this is the time once they're off acyclovir, sometime later, they may come to you with recurrence. And this was, of course, a fellow eye of this patient, and there was no vision in this eye. So this is what I'm trying to show you, the recurrent multifocal kind of a stromal keratitis, in a sense that you may have one lesion here, then they may come up with another lesion here. So, and it's a very, very important to take your slit through those multiple areas as to see that where there is present scarring and in which area there is present edema. The moment you get edema in a case which already has a scarring, you have to think that there is already occurring a recurrence in this case. Again, this was a one-eyed case whose vision fluctuates from 618 to 636. But the moment he gets gross edema like this, you know, the vision goes down to finger counting 2 meters. But once we step up oral acyclovir, he comes back to his earlier vision. And since he's one-eyed, he doesn't want anything to be done to this patient. So this is another case I'm trying to show you. This was one of my case only, which I felt this is a recurrent stromal keratitis. And during the follow-up, he just came and said that his vision, this is the OD, right eye of the patient, and that the vision had gone down. And this is the time when, though on my routine slit lamp, I didn't find anything, but on staining, I could find another dendrite coming in. So this is the time when I had to really put the patient back on oral acyclovir, and ultimately the lesion healed. So they are actually chronic cases, and you have to be keeping really a hand on the pulse for these patients all the life, actually. This is another case I'm showing you of a typical herpetic endothelitis, where it's an immunological reaction to virus in the endothelium. And it's whether it's a cytolytic effect of virus on the endothelium, we don't know. And they also respond beautifully to oral acyclovir, 400 to 800 milligram 5 times a day. In addition, we give them topical steroids. And this is also, I'm trying to show that there are multiple KPs. That is the hallmark that you are dealing with viral keratitis with. There might be a very mild edema in these cases. This is another case who had had a multifocal done outside. And 1 month, as I was trying to tell you, within 1 month, the patient reported a diminution of vision. And she presented to me with this kind of a localized area with the corneal edema. And the surgeon was very sure that nothing wrong had happened and she had regained the vision earlier. But basically, she had recurrence of viral keratitis, put the patient oral acyclovir, and the whole lesion healed. The other form of viral keratitis could be in the form of a trophic ulcers or indolent ulcers. and you may get a small kind of a facet here, non-resolving, and herpetic viral infections of the ocular surface is a major cause for the development of neurotrophic. They may also land up with these kind of lesions, and they might be mistaken as geographical ulcers, but actually these are neurotrophic ulcers going on for a very long time, and underlying stroma opacifies, and they heal beautifully with local with tarsorrhaphy or increase in the lubricants in these patients. So this is how the ulcer resolves and we leave a nebulomacular opacity. So the common presentations I've already been telling you of viral keratitis is a combined presentation of by epithelium and the stroma. So epithelium, you may have this kind of a lesion, a kind of a dendrite and an underlying stromal edema. So you have to evaluate which layer of the cornea is effective and then accordingly utilize your therapeutic modality. And this is another thing I want to tell you, that if suppose there are cases in which you may get some stromal opacity, and at times, you know, being corneal surgeons, at least I am not very, very forthcoming in doing any surgery in these patients, or even a corneal graft is never my first priority in these cases. But suppose these cases, one lands up and doing a simple cataract surgery. In this case, I did a cataract. I did a phaco in this case. But once the patient was on topical steroids and antiviral, I hadn't given because the patient had not come to me as a case of viral keratitis. A small opacity was there. But during the follow-up, the patient landed up with the secondary infection and you can see a hypopyon. So you have to really take these cases very properly. And this is another case which I want to show. This is one of my cases only who had a recurrent stromal keratitis. He had healed very nicely and he was maintaining a vision of 624 actually. And you can see this was a scar. And he was following up very irregularly. Then on during the follow-up, I noticed a small area coming up, you know, which had taken up a stain. There was edema. And at this time, I had stepped up the oral acyclovir. And with this, when I followed up, he showed no improvement at all. Rather, he worsened. And over the period of time, they developed a lot of vascularization. I wasn't sure what I'm dealing with. And this is the way you can see from this cornea, the cornea has worsened. A lot of vascularization coming up. And even he got a secondary infection meanwhile. And this is the time when I treated the patient with antifungals and finally took him off. And now he's only on valacyclovir. And I don't have his latest picture over here, but the cornea has cleared a lot after this. And he's again come back to 660. So it's very difficult to really know what's happening in these cases. And this is how we have applied the different studies, the herpetic eye disease study, which really played on the role of topical steroids. It said that topical steroids significantly improve the stromal keratitis vis-a-vis a placebo. And oral acyclovir, the biggest thing benefit which we got from HEDS was the use of oral acyclovir. Maybe at that time in US, topical acyclovir was not FDA approved, though now it is approved. At that time, they said that oral acyclovir is beneficial in early resolution of stromal keratitis when used as an adjunct, 200 milligram five times a day. Statistically, they did not find any significant results. And it is always to be used as an adjunct to topical steroid therapy in stromal keratitis treatment. Then an oral acyclovir was found to be beneficial in the treatment of iridocyclitis with topical prednisolone and TFT. So how do we apply this in our scenario? I will come to it later. In HEDS 2, they said, there was no additional benefit of 3-week course of oral acyclovir in preventing stromal keratitis or iritis. We very often see cases present to us with initial typical dendrite or epithelial keratitis, and then sometime down the line, they present with stromal keratitis. So they said that there was no additional benefit if you give them oral acyclovir in the case of epithelial keratitis. But important role was of oral acyclovir 4-mg BD for 1 year. It reduces the recurrence rate of HSV epithelial and stromal keratitis, which is like, now it's a 20-year-old study, but it is proven that oral OCV has definitely got a role in preventing the recurrence. And we are using it very commonly in our patients. And sometimes patients get sick of it and ask, when are you going to stop it? But once a patient is in oral acyclovir, it becomes almost a lifelong treatment. Triggers for HSV have been found that would be trauma in the form of surgery, as I've already told you, or any injury or any laser. I have had recurrence in my post-DALC cases. So if you are doing a DALC in cases of a simple, you think it's a simple corneal opacity, surgery cases have gone absolutely uneventful, but still there was severe stromal edema in the follow-up. And later I analyzed that maybe I'm dealing with a case which is of a viral keratitis. Because when the case comes to you at that time you simple have corneal opacity, you don't have any means to know you're dealing with viral keratitis. The treatment options are topical TFT, topical acyclovir, which I firmly believe is a first-line treatment. And I resort to 3% of it 5 times a day in active epithelial keratitis when the stain is positive. It has less of ocular surface toxicity. Of course, you have to be very careful. And it is, again, I have seen that cases of maybe granular dystrophy or recurrent corneal erosions or dry eye are sometimes mistakenly treated as cases of viral keratitis and given acyclovir, and it further worsens the condition. So you really have to know what you're treating with. Ganciclovir is another new drug. And well, nothing is over the acyclovir. And oral medication is preferred to avoid ocular toxicity from topical therapy. And this is another drug I'm telling you, talking about a valacyclovir. Valacyclovir is a newer antiviral prodrug. Acyclovir per se has a very short span. Bioavailability is very less, and so therefore we need to use it 5 times a day. Valacyclovir, we need to use it 3 times a day. It may have a better ocular penetration, and the dose is 1 gram 3 times a day. While if you use oral acyclovir in active stage, when I use 400 milligram 5 times a day. So these are the need for the use of systemic antiviral in herpetic eye disease. He says antivirals, they prevent the recurrent episode of herpetic stromal keratitis. It has low absorption, oral therefore it is frequent dosing is needed. Valacyclovir is an alternate to acyclovir. There is, as I said, higher bioavailability of valacyclovir with respect to acyclovir. So this is how the dosing has been combined. If you have 800 milligram acyclovir 5 times a day, it is equivalent to 500 milligram of valacyclovir 3 times a day. And 400 of milligram of acyclovir BD when we use in a prophylactic dose, equivalent of that is 500 milligram valacyclovir once a day. So a lot of my patients nowadays are on oral valacyclovir OD 500 milligram. You also have famciclovir also available, which is 250 to 500 milligram orally 3 times a day. So there's another drug, which is ganciclovir, and like topically, it has been used, and it doesn't give you any another added benefit over acyclovir. It is comes in the form of 0.15% topical active ganciclovir gel is available. Only advantage of this is to be used 3 times a day, unlike acyclovir, which is used 5 times a day. Whenever we do PK in a case of herpetic keratitis, you have to be careful that these cases are more prone to glaucoma, graft rejection, and disease recurrence. And as I said, that herpes is latent. There are latency-associated transcripts which are there, which maintain the latency of the virus. They do not let the virus to be encoded. And it is involved in the neuronal survival and suppression of apoptosis. So there are a lot of research going on and the working of getting the latch there so that the virus stays latent. So we need to have a proper balance as far as the diagnostic is concerned, as far as the use of topical or systemic antiviral is concerned, topical steroids are concerned, topical anti-glaucoma, lubricants, dosage of systemic antiviral, and acyclovir or valacyclovir and surgery. So when we use a proper balance of all these things, you really have a viral keratitis which is treated very well. Thank you very much. Thanks for your patience.
Thank you, ma'am, for that very detailed presentation on viral keratitis. And I would now request Rajesh Sinha to speak on acanthamoeba keratitis.
Ma'am, can you stop sharing?
Yeah, we did not talk about the biggest virus nowadays, and that is coronavirus.
Yeah.
There is a question there which says, can corona cause keratitis?
Corona has been, I mean, they're just thinking that corona may cause conjunctivitis, but otherwise there are no reported cases of corona.
So there are reports of conjunctivitis from China.
Yeah, but then They're not very sure. Yeah. They're not isolated.
But the Singapore study showed no evidence in conjunctivitis patients. So,
that's all. Whether that hyperemia is because of other disease rather than
fever. So thank you very much. A very good evening to all of you. I'll be talking about acanthium bacteritis, which is fortunately not very common, not as common as bacterial, viral, or fungal keratitis. And majority of these cases are seen with either contact lens users or those who are using contact lens. They had a trauma with, brackish or contaminated water. Or those who use all contact lenses, they use homemade saline. There's a study which was done in London, and they evaluated tap water for amoeba, and they found out that 80% of the samples had amoeba in tap water. So that's what we can expect in tropical countries like ours as well. And so it is very essential to maintain contact lens in a better way, so as we don't have contact acanthium bacteritis. It is mostly unilateral. It has severe pain, which is very much pathognomonic of acanthium amoeba. It is said that it is the pain is much more than what the signs are, and it is mostly seen. This pain is mostly seen in immunocompetent individuals. Yeah. Those who are immunocompromised, like there have been cases of HIV patients having acanthium bacteritis, proven acanthium bacteritis, but with no pain. So that is why it is said that in immunocompetent individuals, the pain is quite severe. And most of the times, we diagnose acanthium bacteritis only when we don't get anything in terms of bacteria, virus, or fungus. So it comes as a sort of an exclusion, diagnosis of exclusion. Once you don't get anything, you investigate for acanthium amoeba and then you get it, because it's not that common. So that's why people investigate for commoner organisms first. However, there can be certain specific symptoms and signs which can guide you towards having highest degree of suspicion, and that's how you can have a chance of diagnosing acanthium amoeba. So pain, as I said, is quite severe. Out of proportion to the signs that are seen, then redness, photophobia, and blurring of vision as seen in any other keratitis. The patient initially can present with epithelial irregularity, which can be punctate, it can be linear, it can be pseudodendritic form, which is mostly seen in early disease. And you can also have patchy stromal infiltrates and radial perineural infiltrates. And it is extremely uncommon to see these findings when you are sitting in a major tertiary care hospital. And many times you get conditions like this, bad ring ulcers and perforations with acanthium bacteritis. And then you are in real trouble of managing these patients. Now, you can have something like this, a ring infiltrate that can be seen with acanthium amoeba. This is acanthium amoeba ring infiltrate that is being shown. So, as far as signs are concerned, other signs are concerned, it has a slow progression. There are the periods of remission is from days to months. It takes a lot of time. Many times you see that the infiltrates are not very dense, but they persist for very long with a large epithelial defect, sometimes involving the whole of cornea. And mostly they have absence of corneal neovascularization. However, these acanthium bacteritis is another condition wherein you get, many times you get a lot of inflammation as you see in viral keratitis. And you can have scleritis, you can have limbitis. So you can have limbitis like this, which can be seen in many cases. Or you can have a very bad scleritis like this. This is one of the cases that reported to me with acanthium bacteritis following a refractive procedure. And then in this case, there was a fleeting type of scleritis wherein she developed nodule in one area, then it atrophied, and then there was a choroidal show again, then in adjacent area, there was a nodule. So it was a fleeting type of scleritis, and gradually there was a complete annular scleritis that was seen in this case. As far as microbiological diagnosis is concerned, we can do a corneal scraping, we can do a biopsy, we can do PCR. Now, confocal microscopy is something which has really helped in diagnosing acanthamoeba as well as fungal keratitis. Now, in fungal keratitis, you get hyphae, you get to see that. In acanthamoeba keratitis, you get to see the inflamed nerves. Then you also get to see the double-walled cysts. As you can see here, there are double-walled cysts. And then as you come to the basal epithelium, you get to see the trophozoites, which are refractile. And trophozoites, cysts are typically polygonal and double-walled, and they stain with calcofluor white and with PAS as well. Then calcofluor white, it typically gives apple green fluorescence. And in cultures, it is cultured on non-nutrient agar with live or killed gram-negative bacteria. So why we do it, that normally what happens that whenever there's a growth of acanthamoeba, it eats up the bacteria. So there's depression, which is called trails in the culture plate. But that can be seen even if there are neutrophils and macrophages. So a serial transfer is very essential, because one serial transfer from one culture plate to the other, again, if you get a depression or trace, this means that it is a proliferating acanthamoeba and not polymorphs, which will die down in the first slide. And of course, blood agar or chocolate agar can be used, as well as PCR, which is fast becoming
think there is some connectivity issue, because we can't hear the slides. Can we meanwhile take the questions? I think we'll have to contact Rajesh. Meanwhile, can we take the questions?
So
it has got stuck. So meanwhile, we'll take the questions. The questions are for one for ma'am, Dr. Ritu Arora. GAN cyclover, VAL cyclover, and PAM cyclover. Do you think in the duration of the treatment there is any difference?
No. Ultimate treatment has to be given for the same period. It's just the dosing which changes. It's just the dosing which changes. That's all. Dosing changes to 3 times a day. So, but otherwise, if you need to give it for long, you have to give it for long.
Can I put a question, Namrata?
Yes, sir.
With the increasing resistance coming to older generation medications like tobramycin, is there a new combination of drugs we are trying for these cases? Combination treatment?
You mean for viral keratitis?
No, bacterial keratitis.
Prashant has to answer.
Prashant
has to.
So,
what are the new sensitivity patterns of bacteria with these antibiotics? Has there been a shift?
I think among the gram-positive bacteria, a vast majority of them are susceptible to cefazolin, vancomycin, which are bactericidal drug. And chloramphenicol also has a very good spectrum of activity, although we do not use that very often. So, we can pick up, for the ease of convenience of preparation, cefazolin and vancomycin can be kept as a reserve drug. But among the aminoglycosides, earlier that used to be the favorite regime that we were using, gentamicin, and then the amikacin became popular. But the amikacin, the disadvantage is that you have a lot of toxicity with the use. So what we found is among the gram-negative organisms, ciprofloxacin has a very good susceptibility, almost equivalent to that of gentamicin. And number two, when you give combination, at least only one drug the patient has to buy. The other drug, they can have the commercial preparation. So what we are recommending is, when you are advising combination, give a combination of cefazolin with ciprofloxacin or ofloxacin. So that's the rationale at present. But if you document that in your cohort of cases, ciprofloxacin is not working, then I think gentamicin will be a good choice. We tried tobramycin in few cases because that is available commercially also, and you can augment the tobramycin, which is available as ophthalmic preparation. But unfortunately, our experience was a lot of toxicity with tobramycin.
And what about when you gave vancomycin in between? Cefazolin was not available, so people started giving vancomycin with in a combination therapy.
The vancomycin, there are two major disadvantages. One is the cost, that's much more expensive. Number two is that we didn't find that it stays the stable. If the patient is not getting it replenished in fourth, fifth day, you find that there is a change in the color, or the patient start complaining of burning on instillation. While we were forced to use vancomycin, we used it mostly for the patients who were kept admitted or who could come to the institute once in 3 days.
So, Rajesh, can you continue your talk?
I'm sorry for the network issue. So continuing with the medical management of acanthamoebatic retinitis, topically we give a combination therapy of biguanide and dimodins, and systemically we can use oral voriconazole. Now, miltefosine is a new drug, which is anti-Leishmania drug, which has been used with good effect in animal studies, as well as a couple of human studies, a couple of case series that have reported good results of miltefosine. And it basically interferes with mitochondrial function and membrane integrity by disrupting lipid activity. And these are some of the studies, a couple of animal studies and a few human studies which has shown that miltefosine works well. Steroid is something which normally is not used in acanthamoeba, but if there is inflammation, if there is severe pain, if there is limbitis or scleritis, one can use steroid. Particularly in a condition like this, as in this case, as I was mentioning earlier, this patient initially we gave systemic steroid, it didn't respond, then we had to give mycophenolate. So mycophenolate is a good drug which can be used in this case. Only thing is that initially we start with 500 milligram twice a day, then we increase the dose to 1 gram BD and then to 1.5 gram BD. So this is how we increase the dose, and then later on we reduce it. And it is given under cover of anti-acanthamoeba drugs, PHMBs. Supportive therapy in the form of cycloplegic anti-glaucoma can be given. And as far as pain relief is concerned, I would just like to mention here that a couple of patients had a lot of pain, and many times they are not worried about their blurring or the eye condition, but the pain that they have in the eye is very problematic. So sometimes you have to resort to opioids, and opioids help well. A couple of patients, I have used lignocaine patch, and then after using lignocaine patch in two patients, the patients were comfortable and they were okay. Otherwise, they were constantly complaining of severe pain. And CXL will be discussed later. A couple of reports have shown some response of CXL and PTK in cases of acanthamoebatic keratitis. And of course, if nothing works, then therapeutic graft has to be done. But again, in therapeutic graft, the risk of recurrence is very high in acanthamoebatic keratitis. So initially, one should try to reduce the load of the organism and then go ahead the therapeutic graft. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you so much, Rajesh, for your very lucid presentation. And now request Dr. Radhika to speak on collagen cross-linking in microbial keratitis. And then we'll come to the final talk after this on therapeutic keratoplasty.
I thought Radhika will speak on Python.
Yeah, I will probably next time. Can you see my slides?
Yes.
Just a second.
Ma'am, please do the presentation mode.
Yeah, good evening. Thank you, Dr. Namrata, for the opportunity. And thank you, AOS, for the honor of the platform. I am Dr. Radhika from Shankar Netralaya, and I'm going to be talking to you today about collagen cross-linking treatment in microbial keratitis. Collagen cross-linking treatment, as we know, has been the standard of treatment to all ectatic disorders like keratoconus. It also confers an antimicrobial effect, which is being put to use in microbial keratitis. The ultraviolet light damages the RNA and the DNA in the chromosome of the organisms. The reactive oxygen species, which is liberated because of activation of the riboflavin, seems to destroy the cell wall of the organism. And the built-up tensile strength of the cornea gives more resistance to collagenolytic enzymes from the invading organism. So that is how CXL works for corneal infection. So what is PAC-CXL? PAC-CXL is a photoactivated chromophore CXL for microbial keratitis. So how different is PAC-CXL from CXL that is done for keratoconus? Well, it is not different at all. The two names have been given for the two procedures in order to avoid scientific confusion due to CXL being treated for two widely different entities, namely keratoconus and microbial keratitis. PAC-CXL has been employed against various organisms. There are many protocols that have been followed, starting from the standard Dresden protocol to the ones which obey the laws of reciprocity, which shorten the duration of the treatment with as much effect. And there are also cheaper options, as well as ones which with lighter equipment, like CXL, which is done on the slit lamp, as well as with handheld devices, which are being studied. PAC-CXL seems to work well in moderate bacterial keratitis and in small fungal ulcers. The effect against acanthamoeba keratitis seems to be variable, as my previous speaker pointed out. And at the present time, there is no role for any kind of CXL in viral keratitis, because we know that it can unmask or worsen the condition, so let's not even go there. When PAC-CXL works, it definitely would reduce the drop toxicity because of the compounded medication that we use for infective keratitis, and also it would mitigate the need for surgery. But we must remember that CXL of any form works on the anterior layers of the cornea. So when there are deep ulcers, they will not be affected by PAC-CXL at all. Especially in fungal keratitis, there seems to be a tipping point, a point where the fungus which grows along the layers of the cornea suddenly starts migrating into the cornea. This is quite commonly seen in people who have been inadvertently treated with steroids earlier. So in these kind of progressing fungal keratitis, PAC-CXL may not have value at all. Below in the panel, you see a patient of moderate fungal keratitis in our institute, having been treated with PAC-CXL along with antimicrobial therapy, who later scarred down completely. So after the tipping point, when fungal keratitis, or for that matter, any ulcer progresses to this level, then what do we do? This calls for, I'm sure all of you will agree with me, a therapeutic PK, unless we are lucky enough, like Dr. Amrita Sharma, to inject and you know, make this resolve. So otherwise, the goals of therapeutic PK will be to eliminate the infection and to reestablish the integrity of the globe. And therapeutic PK in very advanced corneal ulcers carries a high chance of recurrence. Recurrence can happen either because the duration of the disease has been very long, or the organism is very virulent, or the medication is not working, or the patient is not compliant with the medication, or during surgery, infection has been left back. So whatever be the reason, when recurrence does happen, it negates the goals of the therapeutic PK itself. So we were wondering whether we could employ CXL, which was used in PAC-CXL of a keratoconus, to reduce this recurrence of infection in microbial keratitis. So we know that CXL has been used in the donor carrier cornea in Boston keratoprosthesis, because this is where biological tissue meets with plastic, and therefore collagenolysis can happen in a sterile fashion, and the fortified cornea seems to withstand this better. So we try to employ the same principle where we check if organism or infection-induced collagenolysis can be retarded by a fortified cornea. Here, the biomechanical strengthening effect of the cross-linking was being used. So what we actually did was to take the donor cornea before therapeutic PK, And according to the Dresden protocol, do cross-linking on it, mounted on an artificial anterior chamber. This was done for severe corneal ulcers, which required therapeutic PK. So basically, the graft was cross-linked just before the treatment. We avoided doing this in patients who were dependent on one eye with and patients who had perforated corneal ulcers, or those who had other comorbidities, severe infections like Pythium keratitis, the ones which we have not still unraveled completely, or those in whom there were extensive exudates either behind the cornea or in the anterior chamber, or those which had extended to or beyond the limbus with extensive scleral involvement, because we didn't know whether this procedure will work or not. However, the ones who were included, barring these, did have severe infection which needed therapeutic PK. So what did we see? The main outcome measure, obviously, what we looked for was whether the infection recurred or not. And we were pleasantly surprised to see, compared with a set of controls, the eyes which underwent TPK with previously cross-linked donor cornea did show less chance of recurrence. However, this was not without issues altogether. So we all know that cross-linking works best with de-epithelization. The variant in which the epithelium is left intact does not seem to have that much potency. We've seen that with keratoconus. But here, in the context of therapeutic PK, it is definitely not prudent to de-epithelize the cornea. I'm sure the panel will agree with me. So what we did was, luckily, because these therapeutic grafts are usually reasonably second-quality grafts which have been in the medium for a longer time, so usually they will have some amount of loose epithelium or little cracks in the epithelium. So we made use of that for the dye to penetrate inside. Also, these grafts, for the same reason that they've been in the medium with little loose epithelium, would have swelled up a lot. And we do know that the cornea swells, the effect of cross-linking is quite superficial. So that also needs to be contended with. And when the infection recurs because of exudates in the anterior chamber or from the angle, then it's coming from within. And no amount of CXL would be able to retard this infection getting into the donor tissue again. So that was a concern. And last but not the least, the post-operative medication. We know that there are studies underway which show that medication does not reach or penetrate the cross-linked cornea as well as a normal cornea or an infected cornea. As it is, fungal medications are not best known for their penetration. Because the collagen becomes tighter, the influx of the medication is a little less. So what happens is, if you do cross-linking to the donor cornea and there is no recurrence, then it's wonderful. But after the treatment, suppose there is a recurrence, then you have to keep it in mind that this recurrence may not go away with medication, may be indolent, so you must be prepared for a repeat therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty. So we inferred that collagen cross-linking treatment, which is done on donor corneal tissue before corneal transplantation, does have a beneficial role in reducing recurrence of infection after TPK. And both our institute, Shankar Netralaya, as well as All India Institute of Medical Sciences, under Dr. Namrata Sharma and Dr. Tithiyal, have published these results. And in our hospital, independent researchers are also looking in the laboratory, and they also find that at the tissue level also, this cross-linked cornea seems to retard fungus a little better. So, like I already said, for that particular study, which we have extended till date, both in terms of patient follow-ups from that study as well as new recruits, we did not consciously include people in whom the infection had crossed the limbus because we did not know whether this treatment will work or not. So what happens when you encounter this? When you have a small infection which is crossed the limbus, or when you have large infections where we know that even large grafts will leave behind some amount of infection. So when you do a TPK, the rim is not totally devoid of infection, intentionally, sometimes visibly, sometimes at the microbiological level, some infection gets left back, which causes a high risk for recurrence. So we went on to do an extension of what we did before. So we, at this point of time, tried to do a variant of the CXL on the donor cornea. So instead of doing it on the donor corneal button before doing the TPK, we finished the TPK in a normal fashion, made sure that the wound is intact so that nothing goes back into the eye. And after that, we did the CXL on the donor button after finishing the therapeutic graft. So we used ultraviolet beam diameter of about 9 to 11 millimeter, depending on the size of the graft. And we also used a limbal protection ring because we sometimes use large beam diameter. So this worked when the infection was spreading to the limbus from a smaller central infiltrate. So for larger grafts, it was not possible to cover the entire graft host junction. So we decentered the limbal ring so that wherever the infection had reached the limbus or the sclera, the effect of the CXL would be directed there, and elsewhere the limbus would be protected. So basically, you can see here in the schematic diagram, the central part, the red circle is the graft which underwent the CXL, and the penumbra is the zone which has undergone CXL, which is basically the graft host junction, and the umbra outside is the area which is protected by the limbal ring. So TPK CXL part 1 used only the strengthening effect of the CXL on the donor cornea. TPK CXL part 2 attempts to utilize both the strengthening effect on the donor cornea as well as the sterilizing effect of the CXL on the graft host junction. We have been seeing encouraging results. You're just waiting to collate them to gather evidence, and then we shall share them with you. So collagen cross-linking treatment can be done in the form of PAC-CXL for select cases. And collagen cross-linking treatment of the donor cornea may be done before or after therapeutic PK. Though it may not be a fail-safe option, it is definitely to be considered as a worthwhile adjuvant in the treatment of microbial keratitis. Thank you so much, and thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Radhika, for again a very comprehensive peep into the collagen cross-linking in microbial keratitis. And now we come to the final talk, therapeutic keratoplasty in cases of microbial keratitis by Professor J.S. Chittiar. Meanwhile, there are a lot of questions, some of them which are asked to us in all the symposias and all the sessions of microbial keratitis, and there are others which are absolutely fresh. So after this talk, we will take all the questions from the Facebook, from the web browser, will be addressed after the talk.
My slides on there?
Namrata? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Namrata, for inviting me, and a good job done by AIOS in this lockdown period. I think we had a very nice talk on all keratitis, including the initial assessment and medical treatment for these cases. We all understand, despite adequate medical treatment and investigation for these patients, there are significant number of cases which may require a surgical intervention in terms of therapeutic keratoplasty. Therefore, we need to know what are the various indications for taking these patients for therapeutic keratoplasties. What are the various points which makes you take a proper decision for these patients, and what precautions we take, extra precaution we take for a surgical keratoplasty for these patients. And most importantly, what type of post-op management should be done for these patients. Apart from knowing the complications, as management is very, very important. I think these are few slides tells you what would be the indication. You can see this is a case of perforated corneal ulcer and non-healing corneal ulcer for a very, very long time. Large corneal ulcer, which is going to spread up to the sclera, and see chronic corneal ulcer here, impending corneal perforations, or a long-standing cases of non-healing ulcer like neurotrophic cases may require a therapeutic keratoplasty in the meantime. Most importantly, I think the timing of a therapeutic keratoplasty is very, very important. And we had Dr. Manisha talking about documentation, which is so important for a cases who are undergoing surgery, because you're going to remove the patient's own tissue and replace with the other tissue. Therefore, the pre-surgery picture should be there for a patient counseling point of view, because the counseling is going to be very, very important, not only for medical treatment or surgical treatment, because the outcome is totally going to be different in different type of cases, and continuing the topical and systemic medications. As you know, nowadays, all the eye bankings are closed. You have a lockdown. You may not get a good quality tissue for your therapeutic keratoplasty. So you might go for a Gleason preserved or a cryo preserved tissues for this emergency purpose for therapeutic keratoplasty. In the meantime, after it heals, you can exchange the optical tissue as such. But we know that if you use a good tissue, your results are going to be better. In terms of surgical outcome-wise, it depends how effectively you can eliminate the infective tissue or a load from the cornea and the preserve the structural integrity of these eyes. Maybe some patient can see better even after therapeutic keratoplasty also. And most importantly, I can understand once you remove the tissue, you can have a good histopath examination for these cases. And you can have those cases where you didn't have a culture sensitivity report, you can get subsequent to a therapeutic keratoplasty tissue also. These are a few important points for surgery in these cases. If you see a video, this is from Dr. Rajesh Sinha, you can see there's a large perforation which is all around there. You're going to do a trephination which is larger than the size of ulcer. You can see we're going trephination. See all around here, which is encompassing the entire ulcer area. And not to go for a full thickness trephination, otherwise you might damage the tissue. As such, the intraocular pressure will be low in such cases. Therefore, you need to have a sharper trephination or a disposable trephination to be used in such cases. And make sure you don't damage the underlying structure, which is so important to preserve for all types of keratoplasty, and holds true for a therapeutic grafts also. We all understand these type of membranes you keep seeing and in case of therapeutic keratoplasty. And by the time you clean one side, they come from other sides. Sometimes we do use a heparin solution to decrease these inflammatory membranes on the cornea. And the opening of a peripheral area is very important to decrease the peripheral anti-synechia formation. Always oversize the grafts by at least 0.5 to 0.75 millimeters. If you have larger grafts, maybe 1 millimeter oversizing will be considered in these cases. And always go for intrepid suture in these cases. You can see this is one of tissue. You can see this is the area of ulcer. And we have gone at least 1 millimeter beyond the ulcer to do a trephination for these cases. So once you have a tissue in your hand, one half can go for histopath examination. And other two halves can be sent for bacterial, fungal, or other type of culture sensitive of these patients. And this will improve your diagnostic in these cases. So this is one of our case. You can see after 16 months of keratoplasty, this is after 1 year, this is after all the suture removal, you have an anatomical result as well as a visual result for these cases also. But it all depends. You have a larger ulcer, the outcome is going to be a little poorer in these patients. But you can see after 1 year also, you can achieve the structural integrity and you can go for optical grafts subsequently for these patients. In fact, now we have a large series of cases where you've done a DSEC or a DMEC in post-therapeutic grafts also. Sometimes they do have a persistent epithelial defect because ocular surface is a major challenge for these larger grafts. That needs a consideration as such. The larger grafts, poor outcome. Therefore, the decision has to be taken early enough where your medical treatment is not responding, like this case. Though it is eccentric, when you do early graft, you have a very good outcome in these cases. So timing, I would say, is very, very important consideration. Take a decision at the right time to have a better outcome for therapeutic keratoplasty. But major challenge, as we discussed in the medical treatment also, recurrence of a disease in therapeutic grafts. And you must look for basically systemic and local factors. And intra factors are also very important when you do surgery, which I discussed in my previous video here. Larger the size, you have a better, more poorer the outcome. You can see it's such a large graft, multiple sutures, and difficult to take care of recurrence happening in these patients. So this is a smaller graft, but you can see this area is affected. Therefore, it gives a clue that in intra phase, you have not removed the entire lesion from under the definition also. So sometimes you may have to do a freehand dissection to have a better outcomes. But the virulence of organ is also very important. Dr. Rajesh talked about acanthine liver, very poor outcome. Fungal also very poor outcome. Similarly, bacterial will have a better outcome with these cases. Lamellar grafts are also can be considered, especially for cases with acanthine liver keratitis or sometimes patients with bacterial treatment also. But the results of these lamellar grafts are not very exciting as is fungal keratitis concerned. Few things for post-op management. Now, looking for a systemic antimicrobials, I think bacterial, yes, you have to start 1 day prior and continue for 2 weeks. Fungal, you may have to continue at least for 6 to 8 weeks after you have to graft also. Viral, as Dr. Ritu told us, you have to continue the systemic antiviral for a long period, maybe up to 1 year to have a better outcome in these cases. Topical medication, yes, you have to start as you do for a regular treatment for these patients in the post-op phase also. for fungal keratitis. Again, at least 12 weeks is the necessity for these cases. Viral, topical may not be necessity, but systemic, yes. Acanthamoeba, again, you have to continue for a very, very long time, maybe for 6 to 1 year. This, I think Dr. Prashant talked about, when do we start the corticosteroid in a regular treatment? Same holds true for a post-therapeutic keratoplasty also. Bacterial, yes, you can start as soon as possible. Fungal, wait for a epithelialization and at least wait for at least 2 to 3 weeks before you start a full stand steroid in these cases. Viral keratitis, again, it can be given safely. While acanthamoeba, if you have a severe uveitis, yes, you should start steroid also. The steroid can really be considered in those cases where there's severe inflammation after keratoplasty, but only consideration will be fungal keratitis as such. The substitute management is necessary for all cases. Anti-glaucoma treatment is very, very important because glaucoma is going to be there in these cases. If you have a pupillary block or a flat chamber, the patient has to be taken back immediately to OR, relieve the peripheral anti-synechia, and do a multiple PI so that you have a good form chamber, and that will avoid the secondary glaucoma happening in a post-op period also. We know that outcome in a bacterial keratitis is far better. Almost 90 to 100 patients do have a cure rate, and the success rate is almost 50%. A fungal doesn't fare that well. Viral, yes, they also have a good outcome. With the partial thickness surgery, especially like DSEC, DMEG, you do have an interface infection. They are difficult to manage. Sometimes you require a full thickness therapeutic grafts also. Microbial keratitis, in cases with the post-refractive surgery, especially LASIK patients, where you have a higher chances of mycobacterium, you do require a therapeutic graft also. This is one of our case post-LASIK patient. We started with a small ICK picture, ultimately worsened. We de-amputated the flap, had a perforation, and required a therapeutic graft also. So these patients go in a very, very poor manner sometimes also. This is a case Dr. Namrata talked about earlier. This is again a post-LASIK patient, had a small infection. It was spread to the entire area. Then I did a DALK in this patient, quite okay for 6 to 8 weeks, and I had a recurrence subsequently, and ultimately required a large therapeutic graft, and this came out to be a mycobacterium again. The therapeutic graft doesn't work in most cases. Wherever you feel this will be a full thickness graft and more chances of success in these patients. Dr. Radhika did talk about cross-linking. This is our study published in Ophthalmology Journal in 2018 on fungal corneal ulcers. One of the first trials of cross-linked cornea to be used for therapeutic grafts. We found the results were quite good. We had a one-year follow-up and success rate with the cross-linked cornea was better than a non-cross-linked cases in terms of a recurrence and subsequent outcome in these patients. To summarize, therapeutic grafts are required in a certain percentage of cases, despite doing an adequate, appropriate medical treatment for all microbial keratitis. I think the timing of surgery, the selection of cases, and doing surgery in a controlled manner. I would prefer doing a surgery under general anesthesia rather than topical anesthesia of these patients so that you have a comfortable time. Always put an intrepid sutures, make sure you have a good form chamber, and the AC is cleared at the end of surgery. You might inject intracameral medications at that time also. As far as cross-linked corneas concerned, more research is required to see if they are really beneficial for the fungal and acanthamoeba cases. I would say intensive, accurate, appropriate post-op treatment after therapeutic graft is necessary for these patients because almost 20-30% of cases have a recurrence, especially in acanthamoeba and fungal corneal ulcers. Thank you, Dr. Namrata, and we can take the questions now.
I think there are a lot of questions on the Facebook and on the web, and we'll take the questions now almost in a rapid fire kind of a thing. So first, I would like to ask Dr. Prashant, if you have a choice between Getty, Moxy, Besifloxacin, and Levofloxacin, which fluoroquinolone will you start and why?
I can answer that, Levofloxacin.
I think all the fluoroquinolones that you named are basically 8-methoxyfluoroquinolones and are likely to have more or less same spectrum of activity. So as a molecule, I do not have any preference over our picking up Moxy, Getty, Besi, or Levofloxacin. But I think the advantage with the 1.5% Levofloxacin theoretically is going to be its higher strength. And that may probably be, if available, be a choice given if I have to use any one of them.
So what about gatifloxacin, which has benzyl conium? Do you think that will have an additional effect on the antibacterial activity?
So there are publications which have talked about gatifloxacin with benzyl conium chloride, and they showed that they probably may be having some additive effect as far as the spectrum is concerned. But this benzyl conium chloride is in such a low doses that I don't think so that will have. The advantage could be better penetration of the drug into the corneal stroma, because benzyl conium chloride is known to enhance penetration.
And the next question is for everybody, because everybody has talked about microbial keratitis. What are the safe drugs in pregnancy for bacterial, for viral, for fungal? Which drug, if there is a pregnant patient, microbial keratitis, would you safely give? Prashant, first you only answer for antibacterials.
So I think for as far as antibacterial, we are giving drugs topically, and therefore the concentration that reaches into systemic circulation is very, very low, number one. Number two, most of the drugs that we currently use for the treatment of bacterial corneal ulcer are known to be safe in pregnancy. And therefore, there should be no harm in using any of these medications.
Ma'am, what about you in viral keratitis? Unmute. Rajesh, meanwhile, you can think what you use in antibacterial.
Yeah, actually, most of the drugs are safe, but the only thing is that we can teach the patient also that, you know, to close the press on the nasal side so that it closes the punctum after putting the drop. So that will prevent some, drug to go through the nasal lacrimal duct.
How about you? Can we use antivirals?
Yeah. I wouldn't like to use systemic antiviral in pregnant lady, you know. So maybe just give a topical antiviral, that's all. And then as Rajesh says, that tell them to occlude the puncta so that it doesn't go into the system.
The dictum is same, that you can give topical antifungals and avoid systemic antifungals, which anyway Prashant doesn't give. So otherwise also to a non-pregnant person also. So, Dr. Radhika, what do you think? If collagen cross-linking can be done in patients who are pregnant for microbial keratitis?
I don't think so, because given the pluses and minuses of the treatment, I'm talking about PAC-CXL over here. While we would hesitate to do a CXL procedure, for even a corneal ectatic condition, there what we would like to do in a patient with keratoconus is that. You in the childbearing age group, you check whether they're planning a family and you want to do it off before the pregnancy test comes positive. That approach obviously will not be possible in microbial keratitis because it does not tell you before coming. So considering the risk of the treatment versus the doubtful benefit of PAC-CXL, it is definitely not to be tried.
And sir, would you do a therapeutic keratoplasty in your patient who's pregnant and who's come with bilateral corneal perforations?
I think we have to do in such cases. You have a bilateral perforation or impending perforation which is not responding to medical treatment, has to be done, but it depends what trimester the patient is on. Especially in a first trimester, there's a high risk, or a last trimester, maybe a third trimester. Otherwise, the patient quite safe, because if you are doing a surgery in a under topical or with a block, it's still safer. But I would still consider the role of anesthesia there if they are, can be taken up. Surgery should be done. At least one eye can be saved for that patient. You know, bilateral ulceration in such cases would be of mainly either viral or some other etiology. If they are not responding, yes.
Prashant, when will you start topical steroids? Do you think it decreases the scar formation, or do you ever start?
I do not feel that there is any value in using corticosteroids. So I'm not in favor of. And since we are talking to audience, a larger audience, I'll not like to specify in this scenario I will like to use. I think as a broad sense, we should not be using corticosteroid. There is no added benefit. And since many of the ophthalmologists treat patient empirically, it becomes even more important for them not to put patient on corticosteroid.
So bacterial keratitis, ma'am, what is your take on topical steroids?
In topical I mean, as of course Prashant has already said that to this kind of audience we say no, but my reason of starting is only sometime when the ulcer is healing and there is a lot of colon edema, you know, at that time. At that stage, I may start with the topical diluted steroid. And whenever I put the patient on steroid, I definitely call the patient after 24 hours and very, very close follow-up. Because sometimes there may be a recurrence of the infection. Otherwise, no.
Then I think we didn't discuss it in detail, but there are a lot of questions on adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis. One, that in corona conjunctivitis, how do you differentiate when the season is nearly the same? Patients are coming up with that. And two, that whether you should start topical steroids or not in that. And if you do, what is the strength that you would start topical steroids?
See, corona conjunctivitis actually is not really proven. And there is no typical feature you can say. In adenoviral keratitis, we are used to have seeing these multiple subepithelial infiltrates all over the cornea. And they are very, very superficial, you know, localized infiltrate. But there's no typical picture of corona conjunctivitis or corona keratitis,
so,
which are
even in adenoviral, when will you start steroids, if you will, and what would be your strength?
Again, there is a lot of, you know, debate on that, when to start steroid. A, I never start them on topical antiviral. I do see a lot of adenoviral conjunctivitis cases put on topical antiviral. I don't feel there's any role of any acyclovir or calcyclovir in this patient. And when the patient comes to me, if I see those infiltrates are peripheral, not overlying the pupillary area, I wait and watch. But the moment those come over the pupillary area, they interfere with the vision. And that's the time I do give them diluted steroids and topical cyclosporin or tacrolimus also I give. But again, it goes on for a very, very long time.
Prashant, how about you?
So I think as far as the COVID is concerned, my thoughts are that the virus uses very specific receptor to bind to the epithelial cells. And there is a possibility we do not have actual knowledge. Are these receptors present even on the conjunctival or corneal epithelium? As far as my understanding goes, probably not. And therefore, very less likely that conjunctiva will become the seat for bacteriviruses to stay and then cause the disease. As far as the use of corticosteroid for adenovirus is concerned, I want to avoid corticosteroid for first 5 to 7 days because that's the period in which you see most of the viral shedding, and corticosteroids are known to potentiate viral shedding. The indication for the use is where you start seeing pseudomembranes on the conjunctiva or when the disease has resulted into pneumular keratitis, particularly if it involves the visual axis. Peripheral pneumular lesions can be treated or managed using topical lubricant and reassurance to patients.
About you, Rajesh?
I would use, as Dr. Prashant has said, that if the pneumular keratitis is in the center, then I would use steroids, and I will always combine it with cyclosporin because it's known that when you use steroid, the risk of recurrence is high. And we cannot use steroid for an indefinite period. So we can taper off the steroid and continue the patient on cyclosporin. So that is what I normally do.
Manisha, you would do similarly? You are trained in LVPI.
I wouldn't start steroids immediately, but if it is a lot of inflammation, within a couple of days, I start surface steroid like chloromethylone, and then watch the patient once I've started on steroids. And sometimes the patient has been putting some medication. They don't come within a couple of days of conjunctivitis. They usually come in, it's refractive nowadays. So when they come at a refractory stage of 6 days putting medication, I immediately start them apart from just a 4 times prophylactic antibacterial steroid drop. That may be just a surface steroid, chloromethylone, along with the TSH.
There's one more question for bacterial.
1 minute, Namrata. I just want to clarify that theoretically, it is said that when we add topical cyclosporin or tacrolimus to steroid, it reduces the recurrence. But in actuality, I have not seen that happening.
Sir, what about?
No, the only point is that the cyclosporin has some immunomodulation, which you can use it for a long-term basis. Steroids, you cannot use it on a very long-term basis. Steroid, when you use steroid, the risk of recurrence is high.
Yeah,
that is one reason. Although there is no proven thing in literature that prevents recurrence, but perhaps that is one reason, an immunomodulator which you can use on a long-term basis That is cyclosporin. So that
you prefer 0.05%, 0.1%, or 2% of cyclosporin?
I use 0.05% only, ma'am, twice a day on a long-term basis.
How about you, sir?
No, I am very conservative in this regard. I don't start steroid in when the conjunctivitis is there, and try to control all the inflammation, which is normally conjunctival to begin with, and chemosis, redness. And I don't start steroid at all. The only indication for a steroid or a cyclosporin would be a patient who has developed numeral opacities. That too, are coming to the pupillary axis, which has rightly been pointed out. And they have a border which are hazy, or they are coalescent to each other, and they are causing a visual deprivation. If there are clear cut, sharp margins, I never start a steroid or anything, because they are going to be there for years and years and not going to cause any significant problems. If they are, look inflammatory, then only you might start.
Radhika, you would agree. I'm taking a little more on this, because this is a topic which, you know, is not written anywhere in the books, in the papers, and nothing conclusive comes out of it. And this remains a question for always. Radhika, what about you?
Yes, Dr. Namrata. For me, besides the membranous conjunctivitis, which Dr. Prashant already pointed out, there seems to be a very specific stage 2 of adenoviral conjunctivitis, which only some patients pass through. A lot of the time, the stage 3 is very brief, and it sometimes may go on to stage 3, which stays for a longer time. In the initial stages, you have only conjunctivitis, and there's no corneal manifestation. The virus sheds no role of steroid. In the stage 2, if you look carefully on slit lamp examination, there are two or three pointers. The eye is injected. The patient is definitely uncomfortable and photophobic. There are dimples of SPK. Beneath those dimples, there are granular aggregations of, there may be stromal cells or inflammation or whatever. And there is mild stromal edema surrounding these. So a dimple under which a small infiltrate, surrounding which an edema is there. So if we think about it and look for it, we will be able to spot it on the slit lamp examination. And if these get started on the central part of the cornea, those are the only patients which, I would feel like starting the steroid. Many times they don't go to the stage, or they blow over and go to the third stage, where also they are symptomatic because of the scars. The eye is not injected, there's no dimple, there is no edema on the slit lamp examination. Many times this mistakenly gets treated with steroid, which I feel should be avoided.
So then, role of topical NSAIDs. Anybody believes that there's a role of topical NSAIDs in microbial keratitis? I think all of us are on the same page that it should never be started.
No, I do not use.
NSAID is not to be started for these tests.
Okay, then again, now coming to the viral. One more last question for you, Prashant. In your bacterial keratitis cases, how much percentage of the superadded fungal or viral have you seen?
The situation can be that the patient has known to have herpes simplex virus keratitis, then they develop bacterial infection. There is another theory that some of the bacterial keratitis cases have a mix of, but to me, those cases are more of epithelial toxicity or ocular surface problem and resolve very well with the ocular protection. By using tarsorefi, AMG, or avoiding noxious drugs. Now, coming to the question of mixed infection, in our cohort of patients, we had about 2.5% of the cases, culture positive cases, had mixed infection. But there is a caveat there. Many times the bacteria overgrow, the fungi takes time. And if you are using potato dextrose agar with chloramphenicol, the bacteria may not grow. So you may not be able to get a true incidence unless you start embarking on molecular diagnostic tests in order to understand what is the true prevalence of mixed infection.
Okay, so that answers all the questions on bacterial keratitis, and there are again some questions, you know, which are general, like should sodium chloride be given in a case of microbial keratitis? Again, I think has no role. Should eye patching be done? Again, has no role. Another question which is very interesting is that if you have to give a cycloplegic, would you give homotropine or tropicamide or atropine ointment, and how do you decide which one?
Actually, I'm per se against all the ointments. I mean, that's because I feel it makes the things really messy, and sometimes the base of the atropine also gives a lot of allergy. So I prefer topical in the form of homotropine 4 times a day.
What about atropine ointment? Do you ever give it?
That's what I'm trying to say, because atropine ointment, again, sometimes could be allergic, and, you know, the base is a problem. Yeah.
So then there are a lot of questions for viral keratitis. So one is that if the patient is having a graft rejection and you've given topical steroids and the patient also develops a dendrite, so then how do you manage this?
Yeah, this is always a very, very tough question.
You've done a graft for herpes keratitis and patient develops a graft rejection and then the patient also has a herpes dendrite. So how do you manage that?
So here, what we are thinking is graft rejection, it may just be a recrudescence of the viral keratitis. Sometimes it becomes very difficult to differentiate whether we are dealing with the endothelitis or stromal keratitis or graft rejection. So again, we really have to see that at where the KPs are, whether the edema is localized, and you know, whether we are actually dealing with graft rejection or dealing with stromal keratitis. So therefore I'm always edgy. And one thing I always make sure that these patients are on oral antivirals for sure. You know, they are definitely getting, maybe if they were getting 400 mg BD, I may step it up at that time and make it 5 times a day.
Pediatric herpetic viral keratitis.
Namrata, on that previous point, can I make a point regarding the previous question? What I have always felt is that anything that comes on too early after a keratoplasty for viral keratitis may not really be a recurrence. Because my understanding is that if it comes back as a recrudescence, like Dr. Ritu pointed out, from the corneal nerves, then it needs time enough for the corneal nerves to reach the grafted cornea before it can bring the virus back. So suppose it happens very early in the postoperative period, then I tend to feel that it is some kind of an epithelial disturbance because of reepithelialization issues rather than a recurrence of the infection itself. So if it happens later than 3 months, then you should be more alarmed about a recurrence of viral infection. And likewise, apart from looking for keratic precipitate on both sides of the graft, also a dendrite which straddles the graftose junction should also be looked at with caution as an indication of recurrence.
Sir, if you have a recurrence of keratitis and for prophylaxis you have to give antiviral, how long will you keep giving? How long will you keep giving 400 milligrams BD? I mean, what is the longest that people are given or should give to prevent recurrence of herpes in a graft which has been done for herpes itself?
It's very difficult to say because there has been no such studies to prove how long you can give and that will, safeguard your recurrence in these viral keratitis patients. But minimum 6 months to 1 year is the has to be given. And there are patients we have gone beyond 1 year also. And it's very difficult to say what will be cut off, but I will say not less than 6 months for these patients. 1 year normally is a cutoff. For all keratoplasty things, 1 year can be safely given, Suture removal, other things, rehabilitation, cataract surgery. So 1 year, Ritu will agree to that also. 1 year for a prophylaxis.
I have given it for maybe years and years. Years. I've had patients now for maybe 5 years, 8 years on oral acyclovir.
So Rajesh, you have to
ask. Have you found any systemic toxicity with these patients?
No, I keep
getting
their
KFT. Would you advise
KFT
them for a KFT, LFT for
KFT these patients? And LFT keep getting.
So what is the longest
I think that is important.
What is the longest that you would have given, ma'am? Almost.
I sometimes I resort to give it for 6 months, 8 months, and then they give a break for maybe 3 months or 4 months. And then earliest you tell them if they get earliest drop of vision or some bit of photophobia, they come back to you and then I restart it.
What about you, Prashant?
So I think I make a choice based on the case. If it is a one-eyed patient and that's the only eye that has a potential, these patients are kept on the acyclovir for lifelong. They are told very clearly that that's the only safety that we can provide to your graft. For other cases, they receive twice a day as long as the corticosteroids are not being tapered to once a day or lower frequency. So if we are stopping corticosteroids, say 5 years or 4 years, then we can safely ask them to discontinue. But they should be warned and educated that herpes simplex virus may come back.
And Rajesh, you will have to answer this. Where do you get treatment drops for acanthamoeba keratitis?
keep telling him, no, he should have a slide, you know.
Yeah, I'll keep a slide from next time, actually. In our pharmacy, we get it from one company that is Arch. And it basically has all sorts of, it is 20% PHMB, actually. And it has vials, which is of 10 ml vial. It also has 1 liter bottle and 5 liter bottles. So in our pharmacy, we get it from that company and we prepare 0.02%. So this must be freely available. This is basically from the Arch company.
So available, yeah. In Delhi NCR, if you need it, we make it in our pharmacy. And a lot of people from Delhi NCR, they contact me and they get it from there. Because for other practitioners, it's not available that freely.
No, and, it's 20% that is available, that is Arch Cosmosil. And that you have to prepare it in the pharmacy.
This is the last question for viral keratitis, and that is, if there's a disciform scar, how do you, ma'am, differentiate whether it is due to herpes or it is due to tuberculosis?
Yeah, you know, so again, age and disciform hair means it's a fusiform kind of a conledema. And usually if I get a single lesion, it goes more in favor of viral. But if I get in usually tubercular stromal edema, there are multiple lesions. And somehow when there's a disciform kind of, I shouldn't use the word scar, disciform keratitis, in viral, I don't see so much of photophobia. While in tubercular, when there's a conledema, I see a lot of photophobia, and it's even very difficult to examine the eyes of those patients. And in tubercular part, I will see in children. In children, at least the kind of patients which we see. And not in adults.
So have you, sir, this is for you, post-therapeutic keratoplasty, can you start cyclosporin after fungal keratitis because you can't start topical steroids? No questions,
I don't think,
lodging, you know, here and there.
I don't think cyclosporin will have any role in acute, you know, immediate post-keratoplasty phase. It's not going to work out at all to decrease the inflammation. It is basically to decrease the, you know, intraocular inflammation, and surface inflammation would be there in such cases after keratoplasty. So I don't think it has any role to begin with, because as such it will take some time to get initiated, 3 to 4 weeks. So if needed, you have to wait for some time and then start steroids after epithelial digestion and having a, some sort of, you know, no recurrence.
Actually, I would just like to add one thing to it, that what we have found out, that even cyclosporin doesn't help in graft rejection also. We have published 2 studies like that. So basically, cyclosporin is more useful in surface conditions rather than any intraocular conditions. So for surface, it is useful. I don't think it can be used as a substitute for a steroid in keratoplasty.
Just for allergic conjunctivitis.
Yeah, for surface it's good, but not for...
In cases of pediatric viral keratitis, is your management any different?
No.
Manisha?
Of course, the dose changes.
Okay.
Changes and depends on when the patient presents. The pediatric, if it is less than 2 years, it's beyond 2 years, that's what it's going to be. And then
I think we'll take, there are so many questions, you don't know what to leave and what not to. I try to categorize them even then.
Another webinar.
So let's come to the last question, and I think Prashant will have to answer this. Do you think it is useful periodically in tertiary care centers or otherwise also to have your culture sensitivity, drug sensitivity patterns so that you know which organism is responding to, you know, which drug?
That's, I think, the best question so far that we have come across. Very, very futuristic. I think it's a time that we should start having a central repository of all the organisms, region-wise, and have these labs publish their results of what is the epidemiology, what are the antibacterial susceptibility, and I think... you being at the realm of AIOS should facilitate us creating that kind of a database. I can assure you, 5 years down the line, the value addition that this kind of an effort will make for the community of ophthalmologists will be tremendous. So yes, the tertiary care centers have this responsibility of generating information once in few years about epidemiology, antibacterial susceptibility, and so forth.
There were a lot of questions on fungal keratitis, which I didn't ask myself. So, I think I will answer them by email to all those people who have sent it. And this webinar has been very successful. We have huge number of logins on the website. And there were it was Facebook Live, YouTube Live, and people are watching all over. And it's still going on. The questions are still going on. And I'm sure we'll take a microbial keratitis part two some other time. This was more of a basic thing. Maybe we'll cover some more atypical organisms like microsporidia, yes, and we'll have this one more time because I think we have to rise to a more advanced education into microbial keratitis also. And Prashant, that's a great idea. I think we will try to create a network of culture sensitivities all over the country. I'm sure with efforts from all these stalwarts who are here, it will be doable if we get the data. And thank you so much, everybody, for being here. All the speakers, all the delegates who've been, all the people who've been watching us and sending us questions and also provoking us to think. This was out of a question that idea came. And we would like to thank our sponsors, Allergan, for this, as well as Mr. Kripal and Rakhi, who are at the back end at the AIS office managing everything, and Mr. Gaurav, who's our support system from the back, and he's also messaging me that I must thank Allergan for this. Should not forget the sponsors for the meeting. So I have already done that, and thank you so much. And we will have another part two, so please be prepared for it.
Thank you.
I have your confirmations for it, on a public portal, so you all will not say no to it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.